Hi everybody, so welcome to the session 1 of module 1 for the course Elements of Mechanical Engineering. The course code is 18ME15-25. The course is common to all first year undergraduate programs of engineering under Visveshwaraya Technological University. I am Dr. Paramashivaya B.M., Associate Professor, Department of Mechanical Engineering, Kendra Engineering College, Bantwala. So this course Elements of Mechanical Engineering is designed with the following learning objectives. Learn the fundamental concepts of energy, its sources and conversion. Understand the basic concepts of thermodynamics. Understand the concepts of boilers, turbines, pumps, internal combustion engines and refrigeration systems. Distinguish different metal joining processes. Acquire the knowledge of working with conventional machine tools, their specifications. So the learning outcomes, see, that means at the end, after completion of the course, the students will be able to identify different sources of energy and their conversion processes. Number two, explain the working principle of hydraulic turbines, pumps, internal combustion engines and refrigerations. Number three, recognize various metal joining processes and power transmission elements. Number four, understand the properties of common engineering materials and their applications in engineering industry. Number five, discuss the working of conventional machine tools, machining processes, tools and accessories. Then this entire course is divided into 5 modules of 2 units each. Module 1, unit 1 comprises of sources of energy, introduction and application of energy sources like fossil fuels, nuclear fuels and biofuels, hydro, solar and wind energy. Then environmental issues like global warming and ozone depletion. Unit 2 comprises of basic concepts of thermodynamics. In that, introduction to thermodynamics, thermodynamic states, concepts of work, heat and temperature. Then the thermodynamic laws like zeroth law, first law, second law and the third law of thermodynamics. Some concepts of internal energy, enthalpy and entropy, and to solve simple numericals on this. Then steam formation, in that formation of steam and thermodynamic properties of steam, and to solve some simple numerical problems related to steam. So for this, various topics of study under this course, I have given you some links, video links, which you can refer and you can understand the concepts, working principles using some animated videos. You please refer this, watch the videos, and still if you get any confusions, you can ask me during my sessions, online sessions regularly. Then energy. So in your previous programs like pre-university courses or high school studies, you have studied about energy. What is energy? Energy is the capacity to do work. When you have done some work means you possess some energy, and spending the energy you can do the work. Then what is power? Power is the rate at which the work is done. Means the rate of doing work per unit time, what is the amount of work done will give the power. So maybe the work done per second or work done per hour. So that is the power, work done per hour or work done per second. Then, if we go back to the era of pre-industrialization, before the invention of the machines, there was no mechanization, no automation, no industries, nothing. All the activities, all the human activities were done using the muscle power. Maybe human muscles, men and women, or animals. See, some of the activities are like household activities, some carpentry work, smithing work, pottery, or simple agricultural works we used to do using the muscle power. And some of the heavy works like pulling the bullock cart, maybe ploughing, rotating the oil mill, we used the muscle power of the animals. And even for moving heavy materials, we took the help of elephants, or in some cases, for transporting the materials and men and women in that across the desert, we used camels. Like that, all activities were done using the muscle power only. That is before industrialization or before the machines were invented. But after this invention of machines, maybe engines or motors. The means engines are the machines in which the energy stored in the form of chemical energy in the fuels is converted into mechanical work and replace the muscle power. Or the material, the motors. Motors are the machines in which electrical energy is converted into mechanical work. So after the invention of these machines, they replaced all the muscle power. Then we say that era of mechanization started, industrial revolution started, or industrial activities started. And energy sources. Sun is the only source of energy for the planet Earth. We all agree because there is no any secondary source of energy for the planet Earth. The only source is solar energy or sun energy. So this energy sources for our purpose of study are broadly classified into renewable sources of energy and non-renewable sources of energy. Energy sources which are continuously renewed in nature and are essentially inexhaustible, non-depleting, are called renewable energy sources, which include direct solar energy, wind energy, tidal energy, hydro energy, ocean thermal energy, bioenergy, geothermal energy. All these energy sources are renewed periodically. Direct solar energy may be daily available daytime, not available nighttime. Wind energy available at some locations, then tidal energy available only at the wherever there is ocean. So like that, they are renewed regularly. But the sources which have been accumulated over the ages, millions of years ago, and if we use them, cannot be replaced once they are used. They are depleting, exhaustible. So they are called non-renewable sources of energy. Then there are some advantages and disadvantages of this renewable energy sources. So advantages are non-exhaustible. So as you go on using, again it is renovated or renewed, and there is no question of exhaust, no depletion. So can meet the demand need if develop proper technology to harvest all available sources. Because as you know, solar radiation received on this planet Earth is so heavy, so abundant, that the radiation received per day on this planet Earth is sufficient for all energy demand of the entire year for the entire globe. So much of energy is available. Unfortunately, so far we have not yet developed the technology, not developed the technology which can efficiently convert all the available energy into useful energy, maybe electricity. So that's the problem. Then, so can we build near the load point, wherever there is a demand, there we can set up the plants or industry and generate power and supply. Then local self-sufficiency can be achieved. So we can set up small units of renewable energy and generate energy and supply to the local community, local villages like that. So that's the advantage. Then all these are non-polluting, except biomass, wherein the fuel is burnt, maybe wood mass or any other biomass is burnt for energy purpose, in which there is release of toxic gases like carbon dioxide, carbon monoxide, sulfur oxides, nitrogen oxides. So that is the main problem. Otherwise, all these are non-polluting. These are some advantages of renewable sources of energy. On the other hand, disadvantages are the intermittent nature of availability. If it takes solar, wind, tidal, any renewable source of energy, they are not uniform, number one, throughout the globe. Number two, not uniform throughout the day. Number three, not uniform throughout the year. Because globally it is not uniform means, say solar radiation is available plenty in some location, hot areas, Mediterranean and all that. So if you go to European countries or cold countries, solar radiation received is less. So if say in India or Africa, so the radiation received is plenty. That means radiation received is not uniform throughout the globe and depends on the geographic location. Number two, it is not uniform throughout the year. So it is available plenty during summer, winter it is less, and during rainy it is very less. It's not uniform throughout the year. Number three, it is not uniform throughout the day. Daytime it is available in plenty, but in the night it is not available like that. These sources are not uniform throughout the globe, throughout the day, throughout the year. Similarly, wind energy or tidal energy. Tidal energy is not available, it's available only near the where there is a sea or ocean. So only at the coastal areas it is available and not available elsewhere. Then wind energy also, it depends on the wind speed. So again, it depends on the geographical location. At some locations, the wind velocity is high. So depending on the altitude, depending on the topology of their surface, so the energy available is varied and not uniform throughout the globe. So like that, and not uniform throughout the year. Okay, it depends on the season also. Therefore, these renewable sources, they are intermittent, not continuous, and not homogeneous, not uniform throughout the globe, throughout the year, throughout the day, like that. There are some limitations, you can say, or drawbacks, or disadvantages of renewable energy sources. Next, fuels. Fuel is defined as a substance which mostly consists of carbon and hydrogen. So we call them as hydrocarbon fuels. Fuels, majority of the component is carbon and hydrogen. Therefore, they are called hydrocarbon fuels, which on burning, means combustion with oxygen, liberates large amount of heat. So fuel is defined as a substance which mostly consists of carbon and hydrogen, which on burning with oxygen liberates large amount of heat. That's the fuel. Then any material which burns cannot be used as a fuel. Any material which burns and liberate some energy cannot be used as a fuel. So to be used as a fuel, it should possess some minimum qualities. So the requirements of an ideal fuel are: it should liberate high amount of energy per unit mass, means it should possess a good amount of calorific value, CV, means the energy density or intensity should be more per unit mass of the fuel burned. The energy released should be high. Secondly, it should be eco-friendly, means it should not be highly polluting, and easy to store, transport and handle. The fuel should be very easy to store, easy to transport, easy to handle. Then should be available in large quantity to meet the demand. Should be available in large quantity. Then should be possible to control the combustion. That's very important. Some cases it's very difficult to control the combustion. Example, nuclear. So like that. Then should have low moisture content. Moisture content in the fuel should be very less. Otherwise, it's difficult to use in the engines, for example, because too much moisture leads to rusting or corrosion of the engine cylinder or more like that. So then it should be non-toxic, non-poisonous, non-explosive and non-volatile chemically. These are some requirements. If all these are satisfied, then that substance can be effectively used as a fuel. Then combustion. What is combustion? Combustion refers to the rapid oxidation of fuel accompanied by the liberation of heat or heat and light. That is rapid combustion accompanied by liberation of heat. That's combustion. Nothing but burning. Complete combustion of a fuel is possible only in the presence of adequate supply of oxygen. So that's very important. For complete combustion of the fuel, we should supply adequate, sufficient amount of oxygen. So oxygen is one of the most common elements on Earth's atmosphere, because almost 20.9 or 21% of the atmospheric air is made of oxygen. Plenty is available. Only thing is we should effectively use that, supply it for combustion and have better combustion. Then calorific value of a fuel is defined as the total quantity of heat liberated after complete combustion of unit mass or unit volume of the fuel. So if we take a solid or liquid fuel, so after complete combustion of 1 kg of the fuel, the amount of heat released is called calorific value. The kilojoules per kg or kilocalories per kg, that's calorific value. If it is a gaseous fuel, then the amount of heat liberated after complete combustion of unit volume of the fuel, say kilojoules per meter cube or kilocalories per meter cube, if it is a gaseous fuel. If it is a solid or liquid fuel, kilojoules per kg of the fuel. So that is calorific value. That plays a very important role in selecting any fuel. So if a substance, if you want it to be used as a fuel, it should possess a good amount of calorific value. That means its energy density, energy intensity should be more. Then only we can use that effectively as a fuel. Then principle of combustion. The carbon, hydrogen and sulfur in the fuel combine with oxygen in the air to form carbon dioxide, water vapor and sulfur dioxide. Along with that, it liberates enormous amount of energy. So under certain conditions, limited availability of oxygen, carbon combined with oxygen to form carbon monoxide. That means when we do not supply sufficient oxygen, sufficient air, then due to lack of oxygen, there will not be complete combustion. Carbon, instead of becoming carbon dioxide after combustion, will form some amount of carbon monoxide. So, which results in a release of less quantity of heat. as you can see here, carbon plus oxygen release of carbon dioxide plus 8084 kilocalories per kg of carbon. Instead, if we do not supply proper oxygen, then carbon burns with oxygen, formation of CO, and only 2430, one-fourth of the energy is available after combustion of 1 kg of carbon. So as far as possible, we should take care that we supply sufficient amount of air, means we should calculate the amount of air required for complete combustion, and we should supply some 30 to 40% excess air so that all the carbon in the fuel undergoes combustion and release full amount of energy instead of forming carbon monoxide. So each kilogram of CO formed means loss of 5654 kilocalories of heat. So therefore, we should take care that we supply sufficient amount of oxygen, means air, for better combustion. So with this, I will complete the session 1 of module 1. Thank you.